Welcome to another episode of Reality Deer Management. Well, as you can see today, we're controlled burning. So stay tuned. You're watching Reality Deer Management. Welcome to another episode of Reality Deer Management. We have someone special with us today. His name is Alan Dieter. Alan's a good friend of ours, and Alan's just recently retired from the Stable Ohio Division of Wildlife. And as you can tell from our intro, we're going to be talking about controlled burning, and Alan knows a lot about controlled burning. Alan averages about 300 acres of warm season grasses and old field type environments while working for the state, and then right now on the private side of things too. Alan, we're in a solid stand of switchgrass, and we're going to be talking about, you know, basics of control burning. We're not going to get in a lot of detail, just basically the ins and outs. And we're in warm season grasses. This is a solid monoculture, and we burnt this, and you were here with me today that I burnt this.
Yeah, I remember.
And what are some of the benefits of burning?
Well, you can see here that this is really taking off. Burning always it releases the nutrients so that the grasses can make a quick start here in the spring.
One thing too is I wanted this to be a solid monoculture of switchgrass. Mm-hmm. So the timing is very crucial as well, is it not?
It is. It is. That early spring is a good time to maintain the warm season grasses.
Uh-huh.
They do a lot much better in that spring burning.
Yes. Which is like in the state of Ohio, for example, it would be, well, this year was really early. You could have burnt in February because due to the warm winter we had.
Yeah, but dormant season.
Yeah,
any time in the
dormant season would be the thing is, and that's just when everything's dead, you know, and you get a chance to burn, you know.
Yep.
So. But yeah, the timing is very crucial on this. So,
warm season grasses are bunch grass. They grow in bunches, and so there's a bunch here, a bunch there, and there's all this open bare ground underneath, which makes great cover for quail and rabbits and
other species. The deer, other than deer.
The deer love to bed in it also.
Yeah, and then that burning it, you know, gets rid of that litter too. That like quail and young bird chicks and move around
exactly,
and stuff like that,
yes.
Which also releases that seed that's laying there too, which promotes that solid monoculture of warm season grasses. So, you know, this is a pretty cool stand. This is about a 3-year stand. It's doing very well, and right now,
beautiful stand.
Yeah, and it's what is this, May, and we're gonna start getting that hot, humid weather. And just the other day, I bet you this stuff grew about 8-10 inches, and it's going to explode. Hence the name warm season grasses.
Yeah.
So burning this at that crucial time to get that solid monoculture was pretty cool. So, all right, Alan, here we are at one of my old field type environments, and I know as of lately, you know, as you learn, you never learn everything about this, and if you don't learn something every year, you know.
There's so many variables to this burning and this habitat manipulation.
Yeah, and I know I'm pushing I shouldn't say pushing, that's the wrong word, but I'm trying to teach my clientele that the solid monoculture, it's good of warm season grasses, and maybe you should have a couple places on your property for, bedding, hardcore bedding.
Nesting,
but, for all species of wildlife, and deer really utilize this, especially, old field type environment, we always preach about, bedding and then food, give them a stress-free environment. But, this stuff that we're standing in around, if you look around, this is 70% of a deer's diet during a growing season. And
that's
if you
right.
have some good stands, little patches of warm season grasses that they can bed in, it's great during the growing season, and also the bedding aspect of during the fall and winter. But,
they might use food plots at certain parts of the time, but by and large, deer's diet is this.
This that we're standing in, exactly. And, if we were to burn this, and timing is a big thing on this too, we're lacking a lot of switchgrass on this section, the mm-hmm. whole field. So timing of the burn was crucial, you know, late winter, early spring,
right.
to promote the warm season grasses.
And, what was your objective when you burned this?
Was that is to promote warm season grasses, because it's still young, it's still patchy in here, so okay. we wanted yeah. to do that. So
yeah,
and as you can
see,
tell,
there's a few plants
yeah.
here.
Mm-hmm.
And,
yep, absolutely. And one thing too, Alan, we got dogwood here, we got autumn olive throughout, we got sumac, mm-hmm. we got the nasty tree of heaven that's in here. You know, what are some of the benefits of burning? Is or at least, you know, getting
exactly
wood,
yeah
debris.
One of the biggest reasons you would want to burn is for woody vegetation control. As you can see here, a lot of these plants are dead. This spring burn killed the top growth, which allows the forb vegetation
yes.
to compete with it a little bit better.
But one thing, you know, you do a burn, it did, if you look at this tree, you know, we did set it back. There is mm-hmm. some still leafy up on top, but this tree, even though it has no leaves, the warm season grasses and forbs are, you know, growing. This tree's still alive, necessarily, in its own
mm-hmm.
way. But, and the same thing with this blackberry and stuff, you know, we burnt this.
Right.
But the roots.
Last year's cane is dead, but
yeah.
you still have, you've got a sprout coming up.
Yeah. So what burn would we, if you have a mate, like, hey, this is a new site, I want to do a control burn to kill back, instead of getting a dozer and all this other stuff in there, you want to set a fire to get rid of those trees without going mm-hmm. in there and messing up the soil and everything else. So what kind of burn would you suggest to everybody that's to set this up, to actually kill the tree and the root system?
Well, if you can burn in the fall, mm-hmm. It takes special conditions to do that,
yeah.
but if you can burn in the fall, the plant has put all its reserves into the plant,
mm-hmm.
and when you kill it at that time, you're depleting its root reserves too.
Okay.
And you are more likely to kill the whole plant
yeah.
then.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Now, like, and it all depends on what you're trying to accomplish here. We're trying to do
right.
the unthinkable, for all species of wildlife, but mostly for deer at the same time. It's like, you know, blackberry, for example, is 28% protein. I don't want to necessarily kill all of it. I just want to set
yeah.
it back a little
mm-hmm.
bit. This stuff I want to fry.
You know? Exactly.
I want to fry that.
Yeah.
So I have to manage. I'm going to have to, some years I'm going to do this, some years I'm going to do that. So it's all how you want to manage your property.
Exactly. Okay? Yeah, usually you can set it back with fire,
mm-hmm.
but if you really want to control autumn olive,
yeah.
you have a problem, you're probably looking at a herbicide of some kind
yeah.
down
yep.
the road.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, well, one thing that we need to talk about is left, is how to do this stuff and how to do it legally. So let's go walk to a certain spot and follow us. So
okay.
The big thing that we've left out, the most important part of any burning, whether it's trying to do solid monocultures or, you know, old field type environments and, you know, blah, 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 is what?
Can you do it safely and legally?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, in Ohio, we're very fortunate that we can use fire
right.
to manage our wildlife
yep.
and forest. A lot of states out there, it's a no-no. And I know, so that's one thing that you have
mm-hmm.
to. I don't want people turning this, you know, web show off and going out there and spraying and lighting gas and everything else. And me getting a phone call going, Eric Long, you know,
yeah.
I don't want that. So the big thing is, you know, you have to check your local laws if you can
right.
burn, if you can't burn. If you can, great. Even if you can, there's still
yeah.
a lot of things you have
gives,
to go
gives
through.
Gives you another tool in the
yeah.
in the box. But.
Now, for those people that don't, that just want to burn after work, I know in the state of Ohio, there is a burn ban. March, April, May. Okay?
Yep.
6 a.m. to 6 p.m., you are not allowed to set anything on fire. So, one thing too, if you're just a common guy wanting to do this, you know, along with following the burn ban after 6 p.m., that's fine.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you have to call your fire department. Call the local sheriff
yep.
department. Let them know, at such and such address, I'm lighting some stuff on fire. There is
yeah.
a fire break,
yep.
et cetera, et cetera. But for people that are managers, like ourselves, you know what, how can we burn during the middle of the day when the humidity is up, where we can have a good smoke and everything else? What some of the pain
okay.
in the butt things we have
all
to
right.
go through?
I tell you, when I was working for the Division of Wildlife, mm-hmm. I would start in midwinter with paperwork. We had to get EPA permits, permission from EPA. We had to get permission from forestry. They're the ones that can put the burning ban on. You had to get a waiver from that burning ban. So there are forms to fill out.
All achievable, but...
Yes, but you have to think ahead. Yes. If you want to burn, you better be thinking about it in the fall, early winter, if you want to burn in the spring. Yeah.
And if you don't know anything what Alan just talked about, you call the local Division of Forestry or Division of Wildlife, and they'll set you a thing. You got to have, you got to be burn trained. If you want to burn during the day, you got to have the training. You got, because you have to have a number. And you have to do a management plan, et cetera, et cetera. But yeah, it's not as easy as going out here and lighting it up. In Ohio, we still have restrictions. But after 6 p.m., call your local authorities. Another thing, the one thing that we really missed out, if we were to set this warm season grass on fire and we don't have what, it's going to burn the countryside.
Yep, you need a good fire break.
Good
that fire.
Fire,
you have to, it's called controlled burning. You have to be able to control it the whole time you're doing it. And the best way to do that is with fire breaks.
Yes.
You want either no vegetation to burn or green vegetation. Mm-hmm. And preferably both.
Yeah. Especially if you're burning warm season grasses. And if you ever had the pleasure of seeing that, I tell you what, on a hot, humid day, you can get 20-foot licks plus.
Oh, yeah,
and
yeah,
if you don't have a proper fire break, just the heat alone will start something on fire next to us. And I know in our situation, you know, instead of tilling, I use a green, a mowed fire break.
It's, beautiful.
It's two brush hog whisks. I mow it simply just twice a year because once it starts greening up, it's the first thing to get green. That switchgrass right there, it was that height, our height.
Yeah.
It had a, you know, 10-15 foot lick to it, did not even think about crossing it. But it's always go be anal, go farther, till green, everything.
Yeah.
Because you don't want to make your neighbors mad. There's, it's costly and you won't be doing it again.
Yeah, the one of the main reasons agencies and people burn is it is very cost effective. You can affect a lot of habitat in a hurry, but if you don't control that fire and it gets out, it can be very costly. Just look at some of the wildfires that go on out west. Well, you know, they can get into forest here and cause some big damage. So always overdo your breaks.
Yes.
You got to keep that fire in control.
Yeah, have water, have your cell phone ready. Have, I mean, you have to be ridiculous. I mean, the safety precautions on this.
Yeah.
Even it's for, especially for people that are burn bosses like you and I, Alan, you know, and then we go out there and light is like, whoa, you know, I should have, my arrogance got ahead of me. But one thing too, you know, is fire, with the fire break and everything too, is if you don't feel comfortable doing it,
exactly,
don't do it.
Yep.
Because the first time you light that switchgrass and it's going to do what it's thing, you're going to panic. Yeah. I mean, I've been doing burning for a long time, and when it starts going, it's like, I get nervous. You know, it's like, I hope that everything goes right.
Right.
You know, and, but for those of you that cannot burn, you know what? There is simple things to do.
Oh, yeah. Yes.
Yeah.
That, there are other options. Yeah.
If you're afraid of the fire, and
other tools.
That's fine. There's other tools. And, you know, herbicide applications and stuff like that. You know, you can use herbicide to gain disking at certain times of the year. Very beneficial.
Very
You know, there's things to do if you're not allowed to burn or you don't feel comfortable about burning. And we'll discuss those in the next episode, so to come. So, well, Alan, hey, thank you for coming out and sharing
always
your knowledge
a good time.
With us and then bringing my tractor back with the tiller.
Your tractor.
Okay. That's in the end.
Yeah.
Hey, I hope you enjoyed today's episode of Reality Deer Management. We covered a lot of stuff about control burning, and I expect you to gain, you know, the full aspect of things. That's for future episodes to come. As my grandpa always used to say, no hurry, no worry, keep moving.
See you next time on
Reality Deer Management.
Reality Deer Management was brought to you by Kaufman Realty and Auction, Base Camp Leasing, Colbert Scouting Cameras, Modern Habitat Solutions, Hillcrest Lumber, Holmes Laboratory, Sagara Fishing Lures, Woodbury Outfitters, Merritt Seed,